So, good day everyone. So here is the fourth lecture on vertebrate evolution. Today we will talk about archosaur evolution. So as every day, I remind you that you should download this video so you can make sure that you can watch it whenever you want without bother about the connection. And remember to take notes. So that you can remember more easily what's happening during that class. So today we are going to talk about the sauropsids with an archosaur skull that all belong to the clade Archosauria, Archosauria. So the archosaurs are characterized by the archosaur skull, the archosaur type of skull. An archosaur skull is a diapsid skull with two temporal fenestra, in addition to which you have an antorbital fenestra and a mandibular fenestra. So the function of this fenestra is not clear at all. So your first question might be, what are these extra fenestra used for? We have no idea. They are also characterized by the techodont dentition. So there is a root. To the teeth have roots, and that's the same condition as in mammal. But yeah, that's also typical of archosaurs compared to other sauropsids. The teeth on the palate are either reduced or absent. Remember, for example, snakes and lizards, they do have a lot of teeth on their palate. It's not the case usually in archosaurs. And if you flip the skull of a crocodile, you will see that there is no teeth on the inside the mouth. The pineal foramen is again absent, just like in snakes and in tortoise. The posture is semi-erected. So what does that mean? It means that other reptiles have a sprawling posture with the arms and the legs on the side of the body, but not in archosaur. Archosaur have a semi-erect posture. This is the beginning of a trend that will ultimately bring the limbs under the body, which is called the erect posture that you find in dinosaurs, for example. So semi-erect posture at least. And this is what you see in crocodiles. If you look for the video of a crocodile walking, you will see that it doesn't sprawl. It has its body lifted off the ground, just like this Gujaina Madiba. Here again, a species that was named after Nelson Mandela. You can see that Gujaina has its limb slightly flexed so that the body doesn't touch the ground when it walks. And they have osteoderms. Most archosaurs have osteoderms, just like crocodiles. So they have pieces of ossified skin in their skin. So the most typical example of basal archosaurs that you find in South Africa, in addition to Gujaina, is Erythrosuchus from the Triassic of South Africa. So that's the big skull. It's the equivalent of the Tyrannosaurus in South Africa. This one was found in Aliwal North. But it's not the oldest archosaur. We have a lot of old archosaurs on the African continent. For example, we have Proterozoicus, which is the oldest archosaur that you find in Southern Africa. It appears right at the Permian-Triassic boundary. So that's the first occurrence of Proterozoicus, and it's quite similar to Archosaurus, which occurs in the very late Permian of Russia. And you can see they share that strange overhanging premaxilla here. So they belong to the same family, the Proterozoicid. And the family Archosauria gets its name, well, the order Archosauria gets its name from Archosaurus. But Archosaurus is not the oldest possible archosaur. One of the oldest possible archosaur is Enigmastrophéus, which is just known by a bunch of postcrania. And here you have the vertebra that have this rectangular outline in lateral view. And this is also typical of Archosaur. So, and this one is from the late Permian of Tanzania. So it might be the oldest archosaur known. So this is a phylogenetic tree of your archosaurs. So you can see that the what I call the animals with an archosaur skull are actually the archosaurimorpha, but inside the archosaurimorpha you have a more narrow group that is the archosauriforms, and inside you have the archosauria, the proper archosauria, which group the crocodile, the birds, and their last common ancestor, and everything that is descended from this last common ancestor, including the pterosaurs and the dinosaurs. So archosauria per se is just the crocodiles, birds, their common ancestor, and everything descended from that common ancestor, including pterosaurs and dinosaurs. So Proterozoicus, for example, is an archosauriform. It's not an archosauria. So that's why I talk about the species with an archosaur skull. It makes things easier. So among the species with the archosaur skull, you have some basal archosauriforms, and should I say even archosaurimorphs, because I include Rhynchosauria, so I should call them archosaurimorphs. Doesn't make a big difference, but it's important. So basal archosaurimorphs include some herbivores and carnivores that look superficially like crocodiles, or not at all sometimes, like the Rhynchosauria. The Rhynchosauria have this hooked premaxilla here that make them look like the Rhynchocephalia. Remember the Rhynchocephalia, the Sphenodon? It looks very much like the Rhynchosauria looks very much like the Rhynchocephalia, except that they, well, the Rhynchosauria lived in the Triassic and they ecologically replaced the Dicynodonts. But the beak, that hooked beak, is not made of the fusion of the teeth, of the premaxillary teeth with the premaxillary bone. It's just the maxillary bone, unlike in Rhynchocephalia. So in Rhynchocephalia, the teeth are fused to the premaxilla to make that rabbit-like morphology, but not in Rhynchosauria. Also, when you flip the skull, there are multiple rows of teeth on the palate and on the maxilla. The Phytosauria is another group of Triassic archosaurs, strictly Triassic archosaur, and they look superficially like gharials, so very long-snouted crocodile-like skull, very thin snout also, like a gharial. The main difference with the gharial is that a gharial will have its nostrils here, somewhere near the top of the skull. Near the top of the snout, while the Phytosauria, the nostrils are here. So it's that depression that you can see here, that shallow depression on top of the skull here. So the nostrils are fully retracted on top of the skull. So that's the main difference with a gharial. And they are strictly Triassic. Another important species of basal archosauriform is Euparkeria from the Middle Triassic of South Africa. Euparkeria is one of the first bipedal archosauromorphs. So you can see that the forelegs are much, much shorter than the back legs, the limbs. So it means that this animal was already bipedal, which foreshadows what's going to happen in dinosaurs. And one last group that is not really represented in Southern Africa is the Aetosauria. We have possible footprint of Aetosauria, but nothing sure in Lesotho. But the Aetosauria are nevertheless quite recognizable. They are one of the first fully armored herbivorous species, long time before the dinosaurs turned into living tanks. Aetosaurs were already fully body armored, and they are easily identifiable because they have a duck bill, like a very blunt snout that looks like a duck bill. And the last group of basal archosauriform, that archosaurimorph. Two slides, two mistakes. It's not too bad. So the last group of archosaurimorph that is noticeable from the Triassic. is the Rawi Sukya. So the Rawi Sukya, it's a group of archosaurimorphs that is recognized by its posture, its leg posture. So I told you there is the sprawling, there is the semi-erect, and the Rawi Sukya have a fully erect posture, but instead of having an erect posture like dinosaurs with the head of the femur entering the acetabulum on the side, the head of the femur enter the acetabulum on the bottom of the pelvis, so which result in a downturned acetabulum. So it's sticking really directly in the acetabulum from the bottom. So this is, for example, the fragment of a pelvis from a Rawi Sukyan from South Africa, and you can see that's the acetabulum, and the femur would come right here below. So the head of the femur in a Rawi Sukya is not deflected like this. It doesn't make an angle. It's straight, and it goes directly under the pelvis like this. So this is it for the Triassic archosaurimorphs. So now we move to the crocodilomorphs. The crocodilomorphs originated in the Triassic, and they still exist today as modern crocodiles are still present. So the easiest way to identify the crocodilomorph is to look at the ankle joint. The ankle joint occurs between the astragalus and the calcaneum. So it's Z-shape, like this. Unlike what happens in other archosaurs that we will see later, the dinosaurs, in which the ankle joint is straight, and it's called the mesotarsal joint. So this is an intratarsal joint, and it characterizes a crurotarsian type of articulation, and this is the mesotarsal joint, completely horizontal, that characterizes the ave metatarsalian joint. We will talk about it later when we reach the dinosaurs. And also what characterizes the crocodilomorphs is the morphology of the lower temporal fenestra. I wrote fossa instead of fenestra. There's no difference between a fossa and a fenestra. I just want to remain consistent in my use of the word fenestra. So you have here the upper temporal fenestra. Here you have the lower temporal fenestra, and you can see that it's posteriorly opened. So there's no bony bar at the back of the temporal fenestra. Unlike if I go back to this one, for example, here you can see a bar in Angistorhinus, for example, and if I go back to Proterozoicus, you can see there is a bar here, and here in Erythrosoicus, there's also a bar. That bar here does not exist in crocodiles. So it's the posterior temporal fenestra is completely open in crocodiles, in crocodilomorphs. So the classification of crocodilomorphs, you have three main groups, two paraphyletic groups called the Protosuchia and the Mesosuchia, and one monophyletic group at the top called the Eusuchia. And the classification is very simple. It's just the extent of the secondary palate. So crocodilomorphs have a secondary palate, which is basically the secondary palate. We talked about it in mammalian evolution. It's a separation between the nasal cavity and the buccal cavity, so the separation between the nose and the mouth. The secondary palate is the reason why you cannot stick your tongue through your nose. If you did not have a secondary palate, you could stick your tongue through your nose. It would be quite disgusting, but you could do that. But it's that structure, that bony structure that we call the palate, but it's actually a secondary palate. So the secondary palate is also present in crocodilomorphs, and in basal crocodilomorphs, only the premaxilla and a little bit of the maxilla is involved. So you can see here that red line here is the position of the coana, of the internal nostrils. But because the secondary palate is pushing back the coana, because it's becomes longer and longer, then you can see that the coana, in the end, becomes ultimately end up really at the back of the mouth. So here the coana opens directly into the throat. So protosuchia have a very short secondary palate that involves the premaxilla and the maxilla only in orange. Here in mesosuchia, the palatine in red is also involved into the secondary palate. And in eusuchia, the premaxilla, maxilla, palatine and the pterygoid here in green are also involved, is involved in the secondary palate. So you can see that the secondary palate is almost as long as the skull itself in eusuchia. And eusuchia contains your modern crocodiles. So protosuchia are usually found in the Triassic and the Jurassic. Mesosuchia are found in the Jurassic and the Cretaceous. And the eusuchia are found in the Cretaceous and the Cenozoic. So let's start first with the basalmost crocodilomorpha, the pseudosuchia. So the premaxilla and the maxilla only are involved in the secondary palate, but it's not because it's the basalmost group of crocodilian that they were not diverse. For example, you have Lithargosuchus or Pedeticosaurus. No one knows really what's happening with the taxonomy of that one, but this animal, you can see, is a crocodile with very long and slender limbs. It was probably a running crocodile, a galloping crocodile. So it would have been quite scary. Fortunately, it was not too big. Then we move to the mesosuchia. Mesosuchia were also extremely diverse. So the secondary palate, just to remind you, involves the palatine, but not yet the pterygoids. So in mesosuchia, you had a huge diversity of animals. For example, aquatic, fully marine crocodiles, which are exemplified by Steneosaurus from the Jurassic of Madagascar. You had herbivorous crocodiles like this Simosuchus from Madagascar, and you can see that the snout is not very long and thin to catch fish. It's very short and blunt, and the teeth, you can see the teeth are complex with those with this leaf shape. So that's typically an herbivorous crocodile. But you can see that the body has osteoderms like a typical crocodile should have. And you have also insectivorous animals like Pakasuchus from the Cretaceous of Tanzania, which is inferred to be insectivorous because it also has very complex teeth, but that mimics those of mammals. So you have kind of premolars and you have kind of molars in this animal. So, and we know that in mammals, this was originally an adaptation for an insectivorous diet. And it was a very small crocodile, about that size. So the skull was quite small. And Laganosuchus is also a funny one. You can see it looks like the snout is very long and very broad. And you have very nice example from Niger and Morocco, probably an ambush predator that waited with his mouth open to catch prey like fish. So mesosuchia were very, very diverse and they really reflect the very high diversity of crocodilomorphs during the Mesozoic, a diversity that was unfortunately lost with the Neosuchia or Eusuchia, just for consistency again. I think I talked earlier about Eusuchia. Yes, so let's be consistent. Neosuchia was the old name, so I should use the new name, Eusuchia. So the eusuchia, so that's your modern crocodiles, and they are not very diverse at all. They all have more or less the same morphology, and they all have more or less the same diet and adaptations to a semi-aquatic environment. So compared to the very wide diversity of Mesozoic crocodilomorphs, including the pseudosuchia, it's really a relictual diversity. The eusuchia are characterized by the absence of the antorbital fenestra. You can see that in front of the orbit there is no fenestra, so the antorbital fenestra is lost, and they have an inset postorbital bar. What does that mean? It means that the postorbital bar, so the bar of bone that separates the orbit from the post temporal for the lower temporal fenestra, is smaller and it's like pushed inside the skull. So you can see it's not at the same level as the rest of the bone here. So there's like a step to go, because there's like a step that goes inside the skull for the temporal bar. So it's inset, it's pushed inside. That's what it means. So the ultimately the orbit and the post the lower temporal fenestra look like if they all form one fenestra that is weakly separated by that very thin and inset postorbital bar. And the secondary palate, as I told you, reaches to the pterygoids. So the secondary palate is extremely long. So you have three main groups of crocodiles today: the proper crocodiles, represented by Crocodilus, the alligator, and the gharial, so genus Gavialis. So the gharial, I told you, has a very long and very thin snout, but you can see that unlike the Triassic, Phytosauria, sorry. Unlike the Triassic Phytosauria, the nostrils are located at the top of the snout, and in Phytosauria, the nostrils would be there, almost between the eye. So the gharial, that's how you differentiate the gharial from a Phytosauria. The alligator, is quite different from the gharial. Just like the crocodile, they have a very broad snout, very powerful snout. The main difference between the alligator and the crocodile is the intermeshing of the teeth. So crocodiles have teeth that intermesh. It means that the teeth are like this. They are intermeshed into each other when the jaw is closed, whereas in the alligator, the teeth are not intermeshed. So the upper teeth cover the lower teeth when you look at the alligator. And also the alligator has a very rounded snout. It looks more like an amphibian in many respects. And one of the important fossil of Eosuchia is Sarcosuchus from the Cretaceous of Niger, and you can see the skull here. So the skull is typically that of a Eosuchia. It doesn't have an antorbital fenestra, and the postorbital bar is inset. So you can see here there is the jugal arch here, and you have a step here that goes into the postorbital bar that is inset inside the orbit. So that's a typical Eosuchian skull. But you can see that it's huge, and it's probably one of the biggest crocodiles that ever lived, and it lived in Africa some 100 to 80 million years ago. So now the other group of Archosauria is the Ave metatarsalia. So we've seen the crocodiles, the Crocodilomorpha, that have a crurotarsian intratarsal joint, so Z-shaped intratarsal joint. And in Ave metatarsalia, you have a mesotarsal joint, so an horizontal articulation of the foot to the rest of the leg. So the result of that is that the crocodiles can rotate their hands like this, and the Ave metatarsalian cannot. They can only move their legs from back and forth like this. So yeah, we're talking about the foot here, so not the hand, of course. So that's my hand, but I cannot show you my foot right now. But yeah, you have to imagine that this is the foot, and this is how a crocodile can move its hand, and this is how an Ave metatarsalian can move its foot. So the foot has a different mobility, so it's definitely an adaptation for running. And the name Ave metatarsalian means metatarsals, so these bones, of bird, because birds do have that type of articulation, as do dinosaurs. So it's one of the strong arguments that makes birds dinosaurs. It's because they have the exact same articulation of the foot. And if you look at the foot of a bird, it's a mesotarsal joint, You have the tarsals. One, two, three big finger at the front and one small finger at the back. And if you look at the dinosaur, you have your mesotarsal joint here. One, two, three fingers at the front and one small finger at the back. So it's basically the same foot in birds and dinosaurs. So that's one of the strong arguments that make dinosaurs and birds close relatives. So now the Ave metatarsalian, they are well represented in Africa. You have one of the basal most, it's probably the basal most Ave metatarsalian is Tilio crater from the Middle Triassic of Tanzania. So it's also the oldest Ave metatarsalian from the Middle Triassic. And in South Africa, for example, you have Nkwebazaurus, if I try to pronounce it well. And Nkwebazaurus, you can see, has that mesotarsal joint. So, here it is, the mesotarsal joint. So you can see the articulation of the tarsals here to the rest of the leg is completely horizontal. It's completely flat here. And this part of the story, in a purely Southern African perspective, occurs during the Jurassic and the Cretaceous. So that's when the Ave metatarsalian were extremely diverse, the dinosaurs and the pterosaurs. And in South Africa, they are documented in three places, in the Zululand Basin near the Mozambique border, not far from Santa Lucia, in the Algoa Basin around Port Elizabeth, and in the Stompoel crater in the Karoo. So the first big group of Ave metatarsalian is the pterosauria. The pterosauria are the flying mesozoic reptiles, like your pterosaurs, basically. So this is one example from Lebanon, Mimodactylus. Unfortunately, pterosaurs have hollow bones, so bones that are completely hollow. You can see here an example of a hollow bone. So this enables the bone to be quite light, and this was an adaptation for flying. As the skeleton is very light, it's easier to fly. But the problem is that you need a very exceptionally good preservation to have fossils of pterosaurs, because their bones are very easily destroyed. So we have very few pterosaurs in Africa in general, and in South Africa in particular. One of the few bones that were discovered were from the Stompoel crater. And we know they belong to pterosauria basically because they are very badly preserved. So the pterosaurs. So the pterosaurs are an adaptation to flying, as I was saying. They had a very long fourth finger. So that finger here is extremely elongated, and a patagium, which is a membrane of a skin, was attached to that fourth finger and acted as a wing. As a result, the other three fingers are short. So this is your fourth finger here, and this is on Mimodactylus. You can see how long that finger can be compared to the rest of the skeleton. And you can imagine that a membrane of skin was attached there and used as the wings. And the other three fingers are very short. And there is also a bone, an extra bone at the base of the wrist that is called the pteroid bone. And this pteroid bone also helped attach the membrane, the patagium. And this pteroid bone was used as for direction. So it's just like if they had a thumb, and if they use if they move their pteroid bone up and down, this directs the wing accordingly. So that pteroid bone is also an adaptation for flying. When you look at the pelvis, you can see here has an extra bone called the prepubis. So it's a bone that is located in front of the pubis. This is consistent in all pterosaurs. And usually pterosaurs have a very short body. And we will see that there are two types, particularly of pterosaurs. One with the short body, but a very long tail. which is called the Rhomphorhynchoidea, and the other will be the next family. I will talk about that in the next slide. So let's look first at the Rhomphorhynchoidea. So they are the oldest pterosaurs that you can possibly find from the the middle to late Triassic, and they survive until the Jurassic. And they are characterized by their long tail and the fact that they do have teeth. This is one example of Jurassic Rhomphorhynchoid from Tanzania. It's very it's very not well preserved material, but because it has teeth, we can say that it's a Rhomphorhynchoid pterosaur. So it's from Tendaguru, the site, the very famous site of Tendaguru, and so it was called Tendaguripterus. So the other family of pterosaurs is the Pterodactyloidea. It's the most famous one, your typical pterosaurs from the Jurassic and Cretaceous, and they went extinct with the dinosaurs at the end of the Cretaceous. And the Pterodactyloidea are much well adapted to flight. For example, they have a syncrome. So a syncrome, it's written here, is the result of the fusion of the vertebrae to the pelvis, and it strengthened the pelvis, especially for landing. And you also have a notarium, which is the equivalent of the syncrome, but for the pectoral girdle. So it's the fusion of the pectoral girdle with the vertebrae. And it also shows that when on land, they were walking on four legs. So the wing was folded over the body, and they used those three tiny, tiny fingers to walk on land. The skull is very distinctive too. So usually pterodactyloids have a long crest on their, well, they have some sort of ornament on their skull, like a crest or a disc-like something. There's always something happening with their head at the back. So they always have a cranial ornament or crests. They never have teeth. So they have an edentulous beak. So there is a lot of convergent evolution with birds, by the way. The hollow bones, the syncrome, the absence of teeth, these are all characters that you will find in birds. The pteroid is very specific to pterodactyls. Another convergence with birds is the keeled sternum. So you have a big sternum. So that bone here, the sternum, is very large, and it has a crest in the middle for attachment of powerful pectoral muscles. So that's an adaptation for flying. And that's also a character that you find in birds too. And as opposed to the Rhomphorhynchoid, the pterodactyloid have a short tail or no tail at all. So, and again, we don't have much material of those pterodactyloids in Africa, but for what we have, we know that there was very, very big pterodactyloid in Africa. So here you have some of the biggest pterodactyloids that were found, Adzygopterus and Quetzalcoatlus, from America and Europe respectively, but in Africa, in North Africa in particular, you have some very big representatives, like these ones, for example. Like we found humeri of very large, isolated bones of very large pterosaurs that you can see can compete in size with the biggest European and North American pterosaurs. So these are, these ones are the North African pterosaurs. So they were probably as big as the others, but for some reasons, they are not as well preserved. And we know this is the humerus of a pterosaur because of that huge deltopectoral crest. So this is the word written here, deltopectoral crest, or DPC, which is an attachment on the humerus for the pectoral muscles. So the pectoral muscles were very big, so you have that keeled sternum, but also on the other side, they were attached to the humerus, and so you have a very big crest on the humerus to attach the big pectoral muscles for flying. for flapping the wings. And the other main group of archosaur, and the last group that we will see today, and you can guess from now that it's going to be a big deal, a big job, is the dinosauria. So the dinosauria, the other group of Ave metatarsalian archosaur, is characterized by the fact that they walk on an erect posture. So the erect posture is really the big thing about dinosaurs, and they have a special erect posture. And maybe I should go back to that diagram that I made earlier about the erect posture. Yes, this one. So I told you about the Rawisukid and how the Rawisukid have their erect posture achieved by articulating the femur straight below the pelvis. In mammals, you have a femoral head that articulates in the pelvis, but the pelvis, you can see, is not interrupted by the articulation of the femur. In dinosaur, you have yet another type of erect posture, the dinosaurian type, in which the acetabulum is hollow. So the hole for the articulation of the femoral head. So if this is your femur, this is the Rawisukid femur, and this is the dinosaurian femur with a head. In mammals, you have a socket for the articulation of the femur. In dinosaur, you have a hole for the articulation of the femur. So there's a big empty space, and that's what is represented now. If I go back to my dinosaurs on that slide here, so here is the open acetabulum. So you have your femur like this, and there is a hole, and the femur articulate in the hole, and that's typical of dinosaurs, the open acetabulum. So it's a very special type of erect posture. Also, another important feature of dinosaur is the ascending flange of the astragalus. That sounds like a very barbaric character, but it's very simple. It's just here you have your mesotarsal joint. So ventral to that, it's the foot, and dorsal to that, it's the leg. Here you have your mesotarsal joint. This is the astragalus, so that's the ankle joint. And you can see that the astragalus has this triangular process that goes up, and this process of the astragalus completely prevent the astragalus from moving independently from the rest of the leg. So because it's you can see the astragalus is not at the bottom of the leg, it's like this, and it's completely taking over the bottom of the leg of the tibia. So it's taking over the bottom of the tibia, and it's completely locked on the bottom of the ventral side of the tibia, which makes it basically functionally the tibia and the astragalus are the same bone functionally. And this is interesting in dinosaur because in birds, we know that these two bones are completely fused together, and they are even fused, and the tibia is also fused with the fibula. So yeah, in dinosaurs, basically tibia, fibula, and astragalus and calcaneum are all fused together in one bone, and this ascending flange of the astragalus is the beginning of that fusion. And it starts already with dinosaurs. So that's the first step toward a more bird-like condition. And in dinosaurs, we see the reduction of finger 1 and 5 of digit 1 and 5 on the foot. So the foot becomes tridactyl with three fingers. And on the hand, similarly, we have the reduction of finger 4 and 5. So the hand also has only three fingers. So on the foot, you have three fingers, but it's those three. And on the hand, you have three fingers, but it's those three. So it's not the same fingers on the hand and on the foot. On the foot, it's finger two, three, and four. And on the hand, it's finger one, two, and three. And this is the also something that you see in birds. Maybe also I should remove that thing. Yeah. So now the oldest dinosaur, so it's heavily debated where is the oldest dinosaur from, but we have two very good candidates in Africa, both from the Middle Triassic of Tanzania. Nyasasaurus, which is known from very, very partial fragments, but Nyasasaurus has, interestingly, Nyasasaurus has an histology, a bone histology that reflects very fast growth. So the lines of arrested, of interrupted growth are not that distinct in Nyasasaurus, which is a sign of warm-bloodedness. So Nyasasaurus would already have the bird-like warm-bloodedness. So that's a very interesting specimen, Nyasasaurus. And Asilisaurus is also from the Middle Triassic of Tanzania, and you can see it's known by much more material. And what's interesting about Asilisaurus is that you can definitely see that the legs are much bigger and much longer than the arms. So that animal was definitely bipedal, like a dinosaur should be. And you can see the hollow socket here, the open acetabulum on the pelvis here. Now, the classification of dinosaurs, and this you probably already know, but if you don't, here it is again. The classification of dinosaur is twofold, at least for now, but again, it's being debated at the moment, but we will follow the traditional view. But if you want to know more about it, please email me and we can talk about that. But yeah, for now, we will follow the traditional classification that divides the dinosaur between two groups, the Saurischia and the Ornithischia. So the Saurischia are your carnivorous and very large sauropod dinosaurs, and they are characterized by their reptilian-like pelvis. So the reptilian-like pelvis, you have, so if this is the front and this is the back, the pubis is oriented forward and the ischium is oriented backward. That's the regular morphology for a reptile. And on the opposite side, you have the Ornithischia, like Lesothosaurus from the Jurassic of Lesotho. And the Ornithischia, instead of having their pubis oriented forward, their pubis is oriented backward. And the absence of the pubis forward is compensated by a prepubic process of the pubis. So it's not like it's very similar to the prepubis in pterosaurs, but the prepubis in pterosaurs is a different bone. Here, the prepubis of dinosaur is just a prepubic process of the pubis. So it belongs to the pubis. So it's a difference from the pterosaurs. And the Ornithischian condition is similar to that in modern birds. But we will see that actually birds are not descended from Ornithischian, they are descended from Saurischian. And this is just an example of convergent evolution. So let's start first with the Ornithischia, so your typical herbivorous dinosaurs, the one that completely disappeared at the end of the Cretaceous. So the oldest Ornithischian dinosaurs are Heterodontosaurus from the early Jurassic of South Africa and Lesothosaurus from the early Jurassic of Lesotho. And you can see the skull. So you can see the teeth are adapted for an herbivorous diet. So the teeth are flat here in Heterodontosaurus. They are leaf-shaped in Lesothosaurus. Heterodontosaurus is quite primitive because it retains some big sharp teeth that were probably used only for sexual display, not really for killing anything, but it was probably adapted for display. You can see also that they have a fossa here In front of the jugal arch under the orbit, and same thing here, there is a fossa. That's a muscle attachment that attaches here on the lower jaw, on that crest, and that's a cheek. So they do have a cheek like mammal do, like mammals do, and so because of this cheek, that cheek keep the food inside the mouth once they wait. Oh, my English is flying away. Sorry. So those cheek keep the food inside the mouth when the animal was chewing. So if you look at a crocodile or a tortoise, for example, if they try to chew, the food goes on the side because they don't have cheek. But these animals had cheek and they could chew their food because vegetation is very tough to digest if you don't grind it before swallowing it. So this is an adaptation to herbivory. Another adaptation to herbivory is the presence of that bone, which is called the predentary. And this predentary bone is it's actually a beak. So, and all ornithischians have a beak of some sort. You can think about your triceratops, for example. You can think about your duck-billed dinosaurs. All ornithischians have a beak, and they all at least have that predentary bone. So there is an extra bone in the lower jaw. And usually the premaxilla is edentulous. So Heterodontosaurus is quite primitive because it still has very small relictual incisors. But after more ornithischians, more derived than Heterodontosaurus, have no teeth on the premaxilla at all. Usually the anterorbital fenestra is small or absent, and it's directly an adaptation to chewing. That anterorbital fenestra is a point of weakness in the skull when you are chewing, so it's naturally reduced in ornithischian. And of course they have the ornithischian pubis, so the pubis is turned backward and has a prepubic process. Inside the ornithischia, I'm sorry, here we are diving deep into the classification of dinosaurs, but I think you've seen, we are just making sense of things that you've probably seen elsewhere. So we are just organizing a diversity of dinosaurs that you probably already know. So, for example, and these are all interesting examples because here you have the Theriophora. So the Theriophora are your armored dinosaurs, the one with the big spikes on the back or the big shell, the tank-like dinosaurs. So the Theriophora are the armored dinosaurs. They are known for having the scutes on their back. They also have quite a broad horizontal ilium. So the ilium is very flat and horizontal on the pelvis, and helps attaching the large muscles that support the gut. So you have that broad pelvis like this that support big muscles, that abdominal muscles that support the gut. And what is very interesting is that they have a very, very small teeth. So they are very big. Gut was digesting the food by fermenting the food inside the gut, but they barely chew their food actually, and they are very, very small teeth. And one of the first examples of those small teeth Theriophoran is Paranthodon from the early Cretaceous of South Africa. You can see that's the maxilla, a small bit of the premaxilla, and you can see the very, very tiny teeth. So they were all herbivorous. And inside the Theriophora, you find your Stegosauria, like Kentrosaurus and Paranthodon from the Jurassic. Well, Kentrosaurus is from the Jurassic and Paranthodon is from the early Cretaceous of South Africa. And you can see they are characterized by these plates and spikes along their vertebral column. And the Ankylosauria, they are the big one, completely armored dinosaurs that lived only in North America, Asia, and in Europe. So there's no example from Gondwana. There is one example from Australia, only one species from Australia of Ankylosaur. That's the only example from Gondwana. And what's interesting about Paranthodon, it's that it's the first dinosaur ever found in Africa. So there was no dinosaur discovered before Paranthodon in Africa. So that was the first one in the 1830s something. Another big group of Ornithischian is the Marginocephalia. So that's your Marginocephalia means the head with a margin. Oh, by the way, there's a typo. So the head with a margin. So the margin refers to the frill at the back of the skull. So that's where you find your Ceratopsian with the big frill at the back of their skull. And that's where you find your Pachycephalosaurian. Cephalo, it's the head. Pachy means thick, like in pachyostotic. So the thick head with, as you can see, a margin at the back. So they both share the presence of the frill, and unfortunately, none of them is found in Africa. So we'll go through them very quickly. Even though they are very diverse and usually well known, they are not found in Africa. So the Ceratopsian, in addition to the predentary in front of the lower jaw, they have an extra bone on the skull, which is the rostral bone, here marked with a small R. So the rostral bone is the counterpart of the dentary on the upper jaw, and it's typical of Ceratopsians, and Ceratopsians are very well known for their beak. They're also well known for their horns, horns above the eye, horns on top of the nasal, and horns on the jugal too. And particularly the horn on the jugal horn is the only one that is common to all Ceratopsians. Not all Ceratopsians have horns above on top of the eye or the nose, but they all have a jugal horn, even the most basal ones that were bipedal. And Pachycephalosaurian, they are always quadrupedal, they are always bipedal, unlike the Ceratopsians, in which you find primitive species that are bipedal and derived species that are quadrupedal. The Pachycephalosaurian are always bipedal, and they have a very thick skull. So they have basically 20 centimeters of bone that protects the brain, and when they were fighting each other using the head like this. So they were headbutting species. And the last family of Ornithischian is the Ornithopoda. So Ornithopoda are your duck-billed dinosaurs, in which you find your Iguanodon and all the gigantic diversity of duck-billed dinosaurs that you can find in North America. They are quite rare on the African continent, but we have examples like Kangasaurus from the Cretaceous, which is known from a couple of teeth they have this very distinct morphology, like slightly curved in lateral view with that crest in the middle and slightly crenulated on the side. That's a typical tooth of an ornithopod. And from Niger, we have this very, very, very nice skeleton of Uranosaurus that is unique in the world because it has a sail on its back, a dorsal sail. So it's the only Ornithischian known to have a sail, and it's from Niger, from the Cretaceous of Niger. And it's the only ornithopod known from a complete skeleton in Africa. Another important character of the ornithopod are the ossified tendons in the tail. So the tail has ossified tendons that create a mesh of ossified tendons that completely rigidify the tail. So it's not very, very well visible there, but it's like a crisscross pattern of tendons on the tail that completely rigidifies it. So it's quite characteristic of ornithopods. And now the other group that is much better documented in Africa than the Ornithischia is the Saurischia. So the Saurischia, just a reminder, they are the ones with the pubis oriented forward and the ischium oriented backward. So they have the primitive reptilian condition that you can see, for example, in Megatnosaurus from the Jurassic of South Africa. I put here Syntarsus because it is more often referred to as Syntarsus in the literature, but the true name should be Megatnosaurus, not Syntarsus. We should use Megatnosaurus now. And another characteristic of the Soriscan, apart from the Soriscan pelvis, is the hollow vertebrae. So they have air sacs in their cervical vertebrae, at least in the cervical vertebrae, if not on the complete backbone. They have hollow air sacs. So if you look at Nuebasaurus, for example, you can see that's a vertebra here, and you can see a pneumatic foramen. So it's the entry of the hollow air sac. And here you can see Giraffa Titan from the Jurassic of Tanzania, and you can see all these empty spaces are spaces for hollow air sac that are reconstructed on this picture here. So Soriscia are divided in two, which is much easier than in Ornithischia. So two groups, one is herbivorous and the other is carnivorous. So the herbivorous Soriscia are called the sauropodomorpha. The sauropodomorpha are your typical herbivorous, small head, long neck dinosaurs, and usually gigantic body, although the gigantic body is limited to sauropods. And they are characterized, as I say, by the small head, long neck, and a very big claw on the first finger of the hand. That's very, very typical. So just the finger one has a gigantic claw. And usually the other fingers are very reduced, so it makes it a very conspicuous character. And this sauropodomorpha is divided into two groups, the bipedal prosauropoda, like Massospondylus that you can see here, and the quadrupedal sauropoda, true sauropods, like Antetonitrus, from the late Triassic of South Africa. So they are the Massospondylus and most prosauropods are only found in the late Triassic and early Jurassic, and the sauropods are found from the late Triassic to the end of the Cretaceous. They will become extinct when the dinosaur become extinct. The diversity of sauropoda, by the way, the most diversity of sauropoda is during the Jurassic. In the Jurassic, that's where you find all the typical sauropods like Giraffa Titan, formerly called Brachiosaurus, but now it's called Giraffa Titan. They are from the Jurassic. In the late Triassic, they are not that diverse, and in the Cretaceous, they only survived in Gondwana, but in Laurasia, they were replaced by the Ornithischia. That's why, by the way, you don't find so many Ornithischians in Africa. It's because the role of the dominant herbivores was still held by the sauropoda in Gondwana. So the Ornithischians are rare in Gondwana compared to Laurasia. So your sauropods are quadrupedal. They have columnar limbs. So the limbs are really like pillars under the body, thick and strong pillars under the body. And the neck is longer than 12 cervical vertebrae. So in sauropodomorpha, you already have a very long neck, but the neck is even longer in the sauropoda. And Antetonitrus is probably the earliest quadrupedal sauropod in the world. So it's also from the Karoo of South Africa. Also, another noticeable thing are the eggs of Massospondylus, of the prosauropod Massospondylus. So Massospondylus, we know a lot of nests of Massospondylus, particularly from the Golden Gate National Park in Clarence in South Africa. So, and these are credited with the oldest dinosaur eggs in the world. So now a bit of diversity of sauropodomorpha. So you have Giraffa Titan, gigantic. The head culminates at 12 meters above the ground. So it's really one of the largest dinosaurs that ever lived. We have another very big possible dinosaurs from Egypt. There is Amphicelias, for example, that was probably also a very big one. From Niger, we have the Cretaceous Nigerosaurus, quite a small one, actually. It's no bigger than an elephant. And you can see the very broad maxilla here. It was a Cretaceous landowner, like it was really adapted for grazing. and it was using its rostrum, its very broad rostrum, just like a white rhino uses very squared lip, like a landowner. And we have in South Africa Ledumahadi, which is the only known very large prosauropod. So I told you prosauropods were usually were smaller than sauropoda, and gigantism started with sauropoda. Ledumahadi is the one counterexample. It was about 10 to 12 tons. So it's probably the biggest prosauropods that was ever found. And it's from the Jurassic of South Africa. And the other group of Saurischia, and the last group for today, is the theropod, so the carnivorous dinosaurs, and they are characterized by adaptation to carnivory, of course. First, the recurved and serrated teeth, very well exemplified by Syntarsus here, or Megatnosaurus, recurved with little serrations, perfect meat-shearing teeth. They have an intramandibular joint, just like the mosasaurs. So the mandible can open not only up and down, but also like this. So because of the intramandibular joint, it can become broader. But the symphysis is not unlike the mosasaurs, the symphysis is still attached. It's not unfused like in mosasaurs. Their skull is different from that of other dinosaurs because in addition of the antorbital fenestra that you can see here, so that's the eye socket here, and that's the antorbital fenestra, they have a promaxillary fossa in front of the antorbital fenestra. So it's, again, an extra development on the archosaurian skull architecture. In front of the antorbital fenestra, you have, again, another fenestra, the promaxillary fenestra, or promaxillary fossa, or promaxillary foramen, if you want to call it like this. It doesn't matter as long as you know that there is a promaxillary something happening in anteriorly to the antorbital fenestra. What's interesting is that, so they are always bipedal, so that's the primitive condition for dinosaurs, but they retain the primitive condition, and then they are further moved toward the dinosaurs because first they have a furcula. So the furcula is the fusion of the clavicles, so the collarbone. The collarbone that you have here, vertebrates primitively have two collarbones. Well, at least tetrapods have primitively two collarbones, so that's what you see here. And in theropods, the collarbones are fused into a V-shaped bone that you still find in birds. So they share that synapomorphy with birds. And they have feathers, like represented in Amoebasaurus here. All theropods, as far as we know, might have feathers. We know that because we have some very well-preserved fossils, one particularly from Germany, that is a very basal theropod, and it does already have some fuzz on its skin preserved. So all theropods most likely had at least very simple feather-like stuff on their skin. So we have just a bit of diversity of the theropods. I'm not going to dive too deep into the theropod diversity, but I think some stuff are quite interesting. So Africa is credited with the largest carnivorous dinosaur ever discovered, which is a Spinosaurus from the Cretaceous of North Africa. They find it in Algeria, Morocco, Egypt, and Niger. So it was quite widespread on the African continent. And South Africa is, well, Lesotho, so Southern Africa, is credited with the largest early theropod. So from the early Jurassic, before dinosaurs were very big, Southern Africa had its big carnivore. You can see here the footprints. That's the only thing that we have. They belong to Kayentapus. And these footprints belong to a dinosaur that was probably, about 6 meters long, so quite a big one. We don't have the bones yet of that huge carnivore, but the footprints prove that it was there. So now you may wonder what was the... So we've seen Uranosaurus that had a sail, and now we have Spinosaurus that is very conspicuous with that sail. Spinosaurus is also well recognized because it has that crocodile-like snout. So it was Piscivorous, and we know it was Piscivorous because we have some stomach content of the family Spinosaurids. But you may wonder what was that sail for. And we don't really know what was that sail for, but what we know is that the modern reptiles that have a sail use it for sexual display, like this crested basilisk. You have the male here that has the sail on the back, and you have the female that doesn't. So we are moving now upward toward the bird-like condition, the avian condition. And one group of theropod particularly is interesting in that respect. It's the Maniraptora. So the Maniraptora means the fifth hand. The fifth because they have very long hands, grasping hands. And the reason why they have this long grasping, they have this grasping hand is because of an articulation, a particular bone called the semilunate. The semilunate is an innovation, a new bone inside the wrist of birds that enables them to keep their hand in that part, to fold their hand in that very particular way that we cannot imitate along their body. So you've seen the birds folding their hands like this. And this is possible because of the semilunate bone. They can fold their hands along their radius and ulna. So that's due to the presence of the semilunate bone. And some dinosaurs, like Rahonavis from the Cretaceous of Madagascar, did have that semilunate that enabled them to have that particular folding of the hand. It's also present in the very famous Velociraptor from the Jurassic Park movie. You probably know it. Do I have a slide? Yes, we talk about Velociraptor in the next slide. So yeah, that semilunar bone is typical of the Maniraptora, so which are the theropod that are the most closely related to birds. Actually, birds do belong to the Maniraptora. Also, the pubis is migrating. So remember, we are talking about Saurischian, so they are supposed to have the pubis oriented forward. But in Maniraptora, the pubis is vertical, like in Rahonavis, for example. The pubis is vertical, so the pubis is migrating and will eventually reach the avian condition. So we are witnessing here the convergent evolution of the pubis toward the bird-like condition. And when you look at the forearms, at the radius, you can see on the radius tiny foramina that are the insertion point for quills. So the quills are your feathers, the big feathers that are used for flight in dinosaurs. And some Maniraptora, like the Velociraptor and Rahonavis, for example, are famous for their sickle-shaped claw. So you probably have seen that in movies, the sickle-shaped claw. That's also a typical feature of the Maniraptora. And here, I would like to raise your attention here. You can compare this, the hand of the juvenile bird, which is an hoatzin. So that's a juvenile bird from South America. You can compare that hand to the hand of Rahonavis here. They are almost identical. It's crazy that bird, the hoatzin, has the hand morphology of a dinosaur when it's juvenile, and when it turns to adult, it has the typical bird hand with all the fingers fused and the claws are lost. So here you have the claws on the top of the fingers, and these claws are completely lost, and the complete hand is fused in the adult. So you see really the hoatzin, the ontogeny of the hand recapitulates the phylogeny. So it recapitulates the history of the evolution of the hand from the Maniraptorian hand to the bird-like hand. And of course, among the Maniraptorian, you have your dromaeosaurid, which are the velociraptors and their cousins.
And they are documented in Africa. The fossil record is not as extensive, but we do have some teeth coming from Morocco, and we do have footprints from Niger, from the early Cretaceous of Niger. And if these footprints do belong to, well, first, why do we think these footprints belong to a raptor? It's because one of the finger is lifted. The finger with the sickle claw is lifted. So there's only two fingers imprinted in those footprints. And we have many, many footprints sites in Niger with those two fingers only. So that's typically the footprint that you would expect from such an animal, from a velociraptor, from a raptor. So the dromaeosaurid would leave this kind of footprints. And if these footprints are indeed those of a dromaeosaurid, then it would be the oldest evidence of dromaeosaurid in the world. So that would be strange, given that we have very few dromaeosaurids in Africa, but they may have originated in Gondwana actually. And so now we move to birds, and of course you probably know already that fossil if you've been in paleontology 3 with me when you were an apes student, you probably already know about Archaeopteryx, and Jonah Schwanier also probably told you in second year. So Archaeopteryx is credited as the earliest bird in the world. It's from the Jurassic of Germany, from the middle Jurassic of Germany. You can see that it associates a dinosaur skeleton with bird-like feathers. So let's talk about the skeleton first. So the things that are very dinosaur-like in the skeleton. First, the skull, there are teeth. So that's really not what you would expect from a bird. You expect birds to have a beak. So they are Archaeopteryx has teeth. It has an antorbital fenestra. It also has the two temporal fenestra of a typical archosaur. You can see that it has claws, very well developed claws. It has the semilunate of the Maniraptorans. It has a very long tail. Modern birds do not have a long bony tail like this. And it doesn't have a big sternum like birds do have. So it has the furcula, the fused collarbones, but it doesn't have the sternum. So the skeleton alone, if you were looking at the skeleton alone, you would say Archaeopteryx is definitely a small dinosaur. It's not a very big animal. It's about that size. So it's a chicken-sized dinosaur, and it's not very impressive. But it has, well, it shows two things. First, that dinosaurs were not all big. Some of them were small enough to be compared to a bird. And second, the reason why Archaeopteryx is considered the oldest bird is because of the wings here. The wings are perfectly preserved. And if you look at the feathers on those wings, the feathers are not symmetrical. And if non-symmetrical feathers are associated with flight, the asymmetry of the feathers make them so the when your feather is symmetrical like this, it doesn't enable you to fly. So you have to imagine it's a cross section of the feather, and if it's symmetrical, like if it's consistently bowed like this, it doesn't enable you to fly. But when it's asymmetrical like this, here the air is lifted and accelerates on the back of the feathers, which create an upward movement, a natural upward movement. So asymmetrical feathers are meant to help the animal fly. They enable the animal to fly. So the fact that as Archaeopteryx has asymmetrical feathers means that it was capable of flying. And so that makes it the oldest bird. So if we had only the skeleton, we would definitely say it's a dinosaur. But because we have the feathers, we say it's a bird. So it really shows you that birds are just feathered dinosaurs. And that's all they are. And many of the characters that you find in modern birds, in the clade Avis, are characters that are directly inherited from the dinosaurs. Just like the presence of the semilunate, so it was already present in Maniraptora, the hollow bones, particularly the hollow cervicals with the air sacs, that's also something that you find in dinosaurs. I told you it's a synapomorphy of the saurischians. The articulation here between the radius ulna and the foot, it's a mesotarsal articulation. It's also inherited from dinosaur. You have the fusion of the two furcula collarbones into the furcula. That's also a dinosaur character. So many, many characters that you find in modern birds are actually directly inherited from dinosaurs. And Archaeopteryx shows us that feathers are definitely one of those features that were inherited from dinosaurs. So in addition to all these characters, birds have a lot of typical characters, so we're just going through them quickly. So they've lost all the temporal fenestration, but they retain the anterorbital fenestra. So if you look carefully at the skull of a bird, you will find the anterorbital fenestra. Usually it's fused with the orbit. You have an edentulous beak, so the two premaxilla are fused and they are completely edentulous. There's no teeth. Edentulous means that there is no teeth. The brain case is usually bulbous and there is a large brain inside. Usually dinosaurs have a small brain, more reptilian looking. The cervical vertebrae have this very funnily shaped articulation, which is called saddle shaped. So the cervical vertebrae have this very special type of articulation that is unique to birds. The sternum is extremely large and keeled, so that's the sternum here. And that's the keel of the sternum. So the chicken breast, that it's the big bone on which the chicken breast is attached. That's your sternum. So that big bone in the middle of the chicken breast that holds the two breasts, that keel is the keel of the sternum. The fingers are all fused together, as I've shown you on the oatzin, but you can see that during ontogeny, the oatzin has separated fingers with claws. But now in modern birds, there is no claws left. And you can see that there's 1, 2, 3 fingers, just like in dinosaurs. The bone is pneumatic, which is an adaptation for flying. The pubis is turned completely backward. So remember, it was only vertical in Maniraptora, but now it's completely turned backward. There is a synsacrum, like in pterosaurs. So the synsacrum is an adaptation. It's the fusion of all the sacral vertebrae to the pelvis, and it enables, it's an adaptation for landing. When they land, that absorbs the shock of the landing. The tail is very short, unlike in Archaeopteryx. You can see the long tail here. Here the tail is very short and it's called a pygostyle. So all the vertebrae are fused into just three or four vertebrae, and the whole structure is called the pygostyle. The legs are much simplified. The radius and ulna are fused into a tibiotarsus. The radius, the ulna, and the astragalus, remember the ascending flange of the astragalus. So radius, ulna, and astragalus are fused into a bone called the tibiotarsus. And the three metatarsals, so the three bones at the three bones that hold the three fingers, the three toes on the foot, are fused into a tarso metatarsus. That's the bone you can see here. So you can still see there used to be three bones, but now the three bones are fused and the fingers are attached here. And finally, there is an opposable hallux on the foot, that you can see here. So in dinosaurs, it was an extra bow, it was an extra finger that was relictual, but in birds, it was co-opted to grasp branches. So again, it's an adaptation for their arboreal way of life. That's all for the sauropsids, and that's all for the archosaurs. So I hope you enjoyed talking about dinosaurs. And I'll see you tomorrow for the next class on synapsids, on basal synapsids. See you tomorrow.